So, thanks a lot, Slava, for the invitation for this wonderful workshop, at least up till now. So I will indeed be talking about, I will immediately write matrix product states. So tensor networks was the title, I think, in the program for the Schwinger model. So matrix product states, as Frank Polman already talked about yesterday, are this one-dimensional tensor network states. I must say, so it's tensor network states. I mean, there's a bigger picture. So in the end, you would want to, obviously, it's a goal that's not attained yet and not immediately attainable. But in the end, you would want to apply this tensor network framework to QCD and to get like new insights into these heavy ion collisions, for instance, where you have real-time dynamics and finite fermionic densities. But this is QCD 3 plus 1, so this is 1 plus 1, so it's much more modest, but let's say a first step, hopefully a first step in that direction. So the work I will present you is work with my student Boje Beyens, also with Jutta Hageman, Frank Verstraeten, all three from Ghent. And then we also did some stuff with Florian Hebenstreit and Simone Montangero from Heidelberg and Ulm. The plan of the talk is that I will give you, a bit of an introduction. It's going to be adding a bit and repeating a bit what Frank Polman already said yesterday, but I will put it a bit differently. And then I will introduce you the Schwinger model and go into the specifics. So the Schwinger model is one-dimensional quantum electrodynamics. So it's a QFT. It's not by itself a lattice model. It's a quantum field theory. And it's a gauge theory. And these will be the two specifics that go into the matrix product state simulations. After this, I will go through a sample, let's say, of our results, because we have many different results, but I'll go through a sample of our results on the slides. Okay, let me start here. So let me start with writing you, just a general expression for a quantum many body state. So you express this, as Franco already said, you express the state in a local basis. So I have my spins here. And spins, these spins, let me give them a local dimension q. So this I index for one spin goes from 1 to q. So for spin a half degrees of freedom qubits, q is 2. You can write this. So this is just the expression of a general state in this local basis. You can write this state graphically in the following form. So it's a rank n tensor with n external legs, each leg range 1 to q. And so what are matrix product states? It's basically giving you an approximation for this tensor in terms of local tensors. Where now these local tensors have three legs, right? So they will have the physical leg. This is just indicating the n dependence, so the side dependence. So but they have like an external leg. So let me put this index here, and then you have two new degrees of freedom, if you want, two extra legs. Well, and let me also put an index n here. This is an alpha index, a beta index. As I said already, the range of this guy is Q. And then the range of your virtual indices is called the bond dimension. And we will take alpha to go from 1 to d. So you have a range of d in these virtual indices. Okay, let me maybe, because I'm taking a fixed bond dimension here, and let me maybe write this in this form, where this is now a vector with only a virtual index. And then you see where the name matrix product states comes from, given this notation. So matrix product states refers to taking these indices as your matrix indices. And then you see that this expression indeed is something like this. You have a virtual vector on the left, and then I have my now matrix, so taking this as a matrix indeed. One. Okay. All right. So now, obviously, it's very simple to write this. But when is this actually true? So when will this be a good approximation to your quantum many-body state? And it turns out that what you need to look at is the entanglement structure. So let's just take a bipartition. So let me call this system A. Well, I want to have more sides here, but I'm not drawing them. Let me call this system B. And then you immediately see, so if you cut your virtual index here, that this amounts to writing your state as some phi alpha A. So the alpha is the index that I'm cutting, and A is this system. So you have a state living on this part of your system. And then we have the same index alpha, index here. And now this is a state living on the second part of my system. Now these are not orthonormal states, but then you can go to a Schmidt decomposition where they become orthonormal. And you will get something like this. These are my Schmidt coefficients. And then, well, let me write the tilde for the orthonormal states. But what you know is that, so if you go to the Schmidt composition, I mean, this is d-dimensional. I mean, you have d different states here. You know that at most, you will have d different Schmidt coefficients here. The non-zero Schmidt coefficients here. And you can write a statement as a statement on the entropy between the two blocks. So you can define your Rényi entropy, which is so this is my density matrix, let's say, of the A side of the system. And then you will immediately find, plugging in my Schmidt coefficients here, that this guy will always be smaller than the number of non-zero coefficients, which is D. So these matrix product states have what they call an area law for the entanglement entropy. So the area law in general, so in general dimensions, is a statement that if you look at a bipartition of your system and you look at the entanglement entropy between both, that this entropy will scale not like the volume of the smallest subsystem, which it would do for general states, but that it will scale like the boundary area. So it will scale like the boundary area of your, of the boundary, yeah? The area of the boundary. And so in this case, the boundary is just a point. And you indeed find that this entanglement entropy, regardless of the size of A and B, is bounded by this constant. Now, the statement on area laws for actual states, for instance, ground states of gapped Hamiltonians, and this is what we will be looking at, is in general dimensions, it's a conjecture. It is strongly believed to be true, but it has not been proven in all generality that in general dimensions, indeed, ground states of gapped local Hamiltonians do obey an area law. In 1+1 dimension, so one spatial dimensions, it has been proven. The first proof was by Hastings already in 2007. And as a corollary of that proof, you can show, an area law for the von Neumann entropy, but you actually also have an area law for Renyi entropies with n smaller than 1, for some values n smaller than 1. And this you can use to prove that for general ground states of gapped Hamiltonians, your MPS will be an efficient approximation. And efficient in that case means basically that your bond dimension has to scale only polynomially in the system size. If you want to have a good description, if you want to have a small error on all possible observables you might want to put here. So also very non-local observables. So obviously. N, so the number of sites, if you're interested in the thermodynamic limit, it's still a very bad scaling. So polynomially there is still a very bad scaling. But then actually recently, in 2015, Huang proved also by looking at the Renyi entropies for a gapped system. So he proved that if you're interested in local observables, so let's say observables living on 2, 3, 4 sites, so local observables, then also in the thermodynamic limit, you're fine with a bond dimension, which does not grow with the system size.
Yeah. What if I'm interested in a two-point function of two operators separated by a large number of sites?
The thing is that your system is gapped and you have an exponential decay of correlation. So in the end, you might be interested, for instance, in computing a string, which is the. Yeah.
So for expectation values in the ground state. Okay.
Yes.
What about non-gapped systems?
For non-gapped systems. The statements are less clear in practice. So actually, I will get to that. I will get to that now. Well, not indirectly, I will get to that. But the general philosophy of tensor networks is you try to capture the entanglement structure of your state. Actually, also this is also the philosophy in higher dimensions where there are less precise statements, but you try to capture the general entanglement structure of your state, and then you have a good approximation. And let me immediately apply this reasoning now to the Schwinger model. So for the Schwinger model, is, as I said, QED in 1+1 dimensions. in 1 plus 1 dimensions, your interaction is relevant. So actually in the UV, it is a CFT, I would say. And so from that, so if you look at the entanglement entropy between A and B, you get a prediction, and actually, because it's one Dirac fermion, I mean, it's an equality I can write here, you get a prediction that this guy should be 1 over 6 log, and then here I should put my UV cutoff. Okay, I'm putting the lattice spacing here. And then here I will put something like the correlation length. And honestly, so this could be 2 times the correlation length or 10 times the correlation length, but it's so what I know from I know it should scale like this. And so applying this reasoning, because we're interested in simulating the Schwinger model as a QFT, and this is, well, not directly answering your question, but indirectly. So in the continuum limit, you want to take your lattice spacing to zero, keeping the correlation length in physical units fixed. So if you look at your correlation length in lattice units, it's effectively diverging. And so you're going to this to the continuum critical point. And for actual critical theories, which really do not, where the gap, so in some sense, you could say that the continuum limit is already kind of a critical limit.
But you're keeping the physical mass fixed.
Yes. Yeah. And I think for like for true CFTs, you can also approximate them with matrix public states, and the idea will be similar. So you will try to push your bond dimension, because this indeed translates, as you see, to this bond dimension that you have to grow polynomially with the cutoff. But you will push the bond dimensions, trying to approach, let's say, the strict CFT point. Does that make sense? Yeah. And obviously, I mean, for CFTs, there are the MERAs, which are precisely the sort of multi-scale entanglement realization ansatz that are precisely designed to capture a different behavior in the entropy. So this is a different approach where you, So I'm already. Okay. So let me just. Just to give you kind of a flavor of the type of computations you need, let me try to. Okay, so let's say I have a Hamiltonian. And let's take it Hamiltonian with local terms that have support on two sides. So one of these terms on two sides. So using this type of notation, I can express this guy like this, right? You need to take in 2 physical indices and spit out 2 other physical indices. And so now, for instance, you're interested in calculating the expectation value. And well, if you do some variational optimization, this is definitely something you would want to compute. So how do you do it? So let me first look at my operator working in on the cat. So I have general expression for the cat here. So the cat is so this is site n plus 1, and then I have the last 2 sites here. So this is my psi, now I have this operator that needs to operate on these two sides. So this gives me something in the graphical notation, like this. And then you want to compute the expectation value, so you need this state, now the bra. And let me, so you need the complex conjugate coefficients, and let me use the convention that if I flip these tensors, that this means complex conjugation. And so then you immediately see that you get this, right? And so now, so the closed lines always means contraction, so but now also these physical indices here are contracted. So now you want to compute this. Let me, for instance, start from the right-hand side. You immediately see that what you need to do is basically apply this operator. This is called your transfer operator. I mean, it's very much like in statistical physics. So you have this operator. And OK, so at first, it has to work on this state. So this, you can think of this as in different ways. But the way I've written it here, it's a state in a Hilbert space of two spins, let's say, each of local dimension d. And let me already write it as a general state in that form. This will, so if this is the state I start from, then I get a different state here. And basically, you just apply it, apply it, apply it. Keep on applying this operator until you end up with your right vector living on this virtual space here. As I said, we'll be interested in working in the directly in the thermodynamic limit. So in that case, finding this vector here amounts to finding the quote-unquote ground state of your transfer operator, the dominant right eigenvector. And then similarly, on the left side, we get this. And so this shows you explicitly that these tensor network methods, and in particular the matrix product states that I'm showing you now, have this dimensional reduction in them. So you have, you start from a d-dimensional system, in our case a one-dimensional system, and then basically your map all your computations, the complexity to the complexity of computations on a d minus one, in this case a zero dimensional system. So we only have two sides, so to speak, effectively a zero dimensional system. So maybe one more thing on this transfer operator, because everything, so all your, as I said, so we will be working, I mean, most of the time you're working in a thermodynamic limit, so it's really one operator for the whole system. And actually all the information on your state is in this operator. You can, for instance, look at the spectrum of this operator. Let's call lambda not the largest eigenvalue. So actually, this guy will be positive and real. Other eigenvalues can be complex, but I'm ordering them according to their complex modulus. And what you immediately find, for instance, if you would calculate this two-point function, so you put an operator here, an operator there, and then you want to again compute the connected part of its expectation value, well, you can see that computing this connected part, the dominant right eigenvector drops out of this connected part, and actually you're left with a part. So let's say I have an operator here, n sites. So if you have n sites, the connected part will scale like lambda n over lambda naught to the power n, n sites, which indeed so shows you this exponential decay of correlations.
For the first calculation of the expectation value of the Hamiltonian, it seems important that it's a local Hamiltonian.
Yes. In general, yes. There are ways to get around that. But in general, yes. I mean, actually, there are ways to get. So Marie-Carmen, I guess, will show us some calculations with non-local Hamiltonians on finite systems. But even on infinite systems, there are ways to work with non-local Hamiltonians as well. But here I'm showing you local Hamiltonians. Yeah.
Okay, local Hamiltonians are enough for us today.
No, I'm also fine with local Hamiltonians.
What if your eigenvalues are degenerate? Can you get non-exponential powers?
Yeah, well, in the generic case, you won't have a degeneracy.
But the generic case is not a critical case.
Right? Yeah, but so this actually is why I first was giving you the entanglement entropy argument, and then showing you this, because this would suggest that even with bond dimension 2, you can indeed tune your transfer operator such that this lambda 1 becomes very, very small at least. And you might go to very, very large correlation lengths. But this is not, although indeed you would have a state with very large correlation lengths, this would not be a good approximation to an actual ground state of a system with large correlation lengths. Because you really need to look at the entanglement entropy for that. Yeah. Okay. All right. So, well, let me now introduce you the Schwinger model. So, as I said, the Schwinger model is 1 plus 1 dimensional quantum electrodynamics. So, the Lagrangian density, I should say, is this. The Maxwell tensor. Maxwell tensor of my gauge field. And so we're working, we're working in two dimensions. You have the Dirac kinetic term. So your Dirac spinor in two dimensions has two components. And let me write them in the Dirac representation. So, and let me write them like this. So I'll identify the first component as the positron annihilation operator in the non-relativistic limit. And the second component as the electron creation operator in the non-relativistic limit. The gauge coupling. Is of course this, and then we will have a mass term in the usual way. Okay, so this is the theory. So why is it an interesting model? It's, in some respects, it's a toy model, and I stress some respects. It's a toy model for QCD because you have confinement, actually already at the perturbative level. So indeed, if you compute your three-level potential. Well, you will get a potential. Let me write this. You'll get a potential, which is g squared x. So x the distance between my two charges. So you have indeed a linearly rising potential perturbative confinement. So this is at the perturbative level. This also holds at the non-perturbative level. And actually, if you want to talk about strong and weak coupling, you actually should look at G over M, because I said, as I said, the theory is super renormalizable. Dimension of G in 1 plus 1 dimension is 1. So this is the dimensionless variable to look at. So weak coupling then also amounts to the non-relativistic limit, because weak coupling is the same as having a large mass. So obviously weak coupling, so this guy is small, while we have the regular Feynman perturbation that we can use, for instance, Feynman perturbation theory that we can use, for instance, to show that indeed we have this confinement. At strong coupling, Coleman, I think in the 60s, bosonized the theory. And you can actually show that the Schwinger model is equivalent to a Sine-Gordon theory, but with an extra mass term. In the strong coupling limit, the Sine-Gordon potential disappears. And so in exactly in this limit, so in the G to infinity limit, basically you have a theory of one scalar, one meson, if you want, one free meson, one free bound state of an electron and a positron. Now this also makes the model attractive if you want to test your matrix product simulations, because we can test them from both sides if you want. And so you can look at weak coupling, results from a weak coupling expansion, and results from a strong coupling expansion. Okay. So now, obviously it's a gauge theory. So this Lagrangian has this symmetry. And I hope I have the signs right. But you have this, your local U1 gauge symmetry. And then, so we are doing, we want to do a matrix product simulations, So at first, we actually want to go to a Hamiltonian, because we want to do a Hamiltonian simulation. So it's not a path integral simulation, it's a Hamiltonian simulation. So what we do effectively amounts to taking the A0 is not gauge. I guess it's called the time-like actual gauge. So in this, so taking A0 to zero, you can immediately write down a Hamiltonian density. So you can quantize this theory on your A1 field, because you only have, so A0 disappears. For the bosons, you only have A1 left, where your canonical conjugate field is a derivative, which is indeed, which is also the electric field. I'm not writing down this Hamiltonian here, but because I won't be using it, but well, as you know, if you put this as a gauge condition, you actually need to put the equation that follows from varying with respect to A0. So the equation so this should be 0 if you vary with respect to A0. You vary your action with respect to A0. And so obviously now A0 is gone. And what you need to do, you need to impose this as a gauge constraint on your physical states. So your Hamiltonian lives in a Hilbert space, which is way larger. Yeah? But only the states that fulfill this condition are truly physical. And this is actually nothing but Gauss' law. Yeah, I'm kind of using notation as it was in three dimensions, but to be sure it's in one dimension that we are working. So this is really Gauss' law, where you have like the charge density. And you can actually also show that this operator, so both terms, generate gauge transformations which are time independent. So it's really asking that my states are independent or are invariant. Sorry, are invariant under time independent gauge transformations. So it's a bit because so if you come from QFT sites, you typically don't want to do this because you explicitly break Lorentz invariants. So you can show that you have Lorentz invariance, but on this physical subspace. So typically use something like BRST quantization or Gupta-Bleuler. But there the full Hilbert space in that case, so you also have like a subspace in this Gupta-Bleuler, but there the full Hilbert space is kind of sick in the sense that you have negative norm states. So this is not the case here. So in this case, the full Hilbert space is fine. It's just that if you want to say, okay, I'm talking about this theory, then you need to restrict yourself to this physical subspace. Okay. And actually, you know what this, so one more thing on this full Hilbert space, you know what this full Hilbert space is. The full Hilbert space simply consists of states that violate my Gauss law. And so violation of a Gauss law, you can simply think of this as having external point charges there.
And you don't want to integrate out completely A1 because this will give rise to non-local Hamiltonians.
Well, depends on your. So this is now. So you can deal with this non-local Hamiltonian. So because as Marie-Carmen will show, so this is indeed one approach that you can do is completely integrating out my gauge degrees of freedom, which gives you a non-local Hamiltonian. But you can deal with this. But this is not what we did. So we also kind of to have a local Hamiltonian, but also kind of to have a general idea how this gauge invariance, which we have to impose on our matrix product states, how this gauge invariance is realized in this matrices. Okay, so now, I didn't write this down, but this is still a Hamiltonian of a QFT. Kohut and Suskind showed us the end of the 70s how you can discretize such a Hamiltonian. So what Kohut and Suskind do is so you discretize your fermionic operator, but what is important is that you will put the positron operator on the even sides, let's say, and the fermionic operators on the odd sides. So you have like a staggered formulation. And this is, specific in one spatial dimension. So with this staggered formulation, you don't have any fermion doublers. And so you have, let's say, the Dirac fermion has the proper dispersion relation in the low energy limit. You don't have any unwanted other low energy degrees of freedom there.
Does that generalize to higher dimensions?
No. This is really specific to. So now the way I'm drawing my arrows, these are still fermionic operator, so they would become something like like indeed fermionic operators with that type of commutation relations. What you do then is do the Jordan-Wigner trick, where you basically, I hope I have it right, where you replace your fermionic creation annihilation operator with these operators, with spin operators. So you replace your operator basically with this operator, but in order, so this is just now the this is the Pauli ladder operator, but you attach this string to it in order to have the right statistics to your operator. And in any case, so if you do this, and I think I can, I will be able to fit my Hamiltonian on this. So if you do this, you will get a Hamiltonian, and let me first write down the mass term. You will get a Hamiltonian with a mass term. That indeed it's staggered, right?
Where do you need to apply this Jordan-Wigner? You have a nice Hamiltonian in terms of these C's and C daggers. Why do you?
So, you don't. It's just that, well, these. So you can. You can also write down matrix product states for fermionic local states if you want. But okay, for the formalism, well, we just use this Jordan-Wigner trick because then we could use the, let's say, traditional matrix product state simulation on spins. So this is my mass term. You get this sigma z, so this is just the spin z operator. So your fermions now become spin a half degrees of freedom living on the sides. You get this sigma z operator at side n. And well, here you see you have a different term for even and odd sides. This is due to this staggered formulation that we are using. And so where, again, this is the positron annihilation operator, but this will be the electron creation operator on the odd side. Okay, so then we have the kinetic term. And so the kinetic term
is like the most important formula that you're writing so far, and you're squeezing it in this tiny space.
Should I? Okay.
I indeed.
The people in the back of the room, I'm not sure. Is it too small? Okay, no, let me indeed. Let me just rewrite it on this blackboard.
Can you write the sigma as sigma?
You mean this doesn't look so much as a sigma? Okay, let me indeed. Let me okay. So let me first. So I'm kind of keeping the order that we have there in our Lagrangian density. So let me first write down the mass term that I wrote down. And then so this is sigma z. N? That's a sigma, no? Is that? That's for me, that is my, I don't know if you feed this into a neural network, what it will. right? Okay, So then we had this kinetic term. So the sigma plus operator, the ladder operator, the ladder Pauli operator, n plus 1. And then here I will write this e to the I theta. Let me write it like this. This is the, well, what's the ladder operator, and then the, I don't know, the going down operator. Plus Hermitian conjugate. So you see that this will kind of amount to the kinetic term, including the gauge field. So this is the gauge field.
So that's the link variable.
Indeed. So the gauge fields, you have to think of this, if this is site n, n plus 1, you have to think of the gauge field as living here.
Okay.
Does it have an index?
It has an index n, indeed. And let me, because I need to indeed take care of my time here. Let me just. So this gauge field, so we're using compact QED, so this theta goes from 0 to 2 pi. So my local dimension of this link, of the Hilbert space here, is already infinite. And so, in order to use this matrix product state, in order to use them, you will need to truncate this local Hilbert space. And actually, so the truncation is best done. And so here I'm writing down the electric field. So you can think of this L operator as the dimension zero electric field, again at site n. So we have an electric field at every site, and this L commutator with e theta is e theta. So e theta is like the ladder operator of the electric field values, and so the spectrum. Of your electric field operator consists of all integer values. And so it turns out that we.
How does it act, if you write a wave function in phi, how does L act on this wave function?
L will generate, e to the I phi L. On phi prime will give me phi prime plus phi. So it's just the momentum operator of your let me. So there are some. Just to get, because if this was the most important formula, I should get it right. So there was a lattice spacing here, and 1 over 2 lattice spacing there. There was no lattice spacing here. And as I said, we simulated this model going into the A to 0 limit. So what should I do now? Because I see I have 7 more minutes left. So then let me just say that the additional ingredient here in order to simulate the system and indeed focus on this gauge invariant subspace is this Gauss constraint. And so the Gauss constraint in this discretized form becomes Ln plus 1 minus Ln. minus my charge has to be zero on my physical states. So this is basically saying, telling me, so I have the electric field here. If I don't have a charge, I want this electric field to be equal to the electric field here. If I have a plus charge, plus one. If I have a minus charge, minus one. And then, so I won't show you this because I'm running out of time. But then it turns out, and you can imagine this, it turns out that you can very naturally encode this, because it's a local thing, you can very naturally encode this in this structure you have here. And this is precisely what we did. So let me now go to the to some of the slides. So what you see there is the Schmidt decomposition. Now, for a general state, so this is not not per se a matrix product state, but for a general space, a general state on this physical subspace. And so this P refers to the electric field eigenvalue. So if I have an electric field P here, then I know what the electric field plus the charge here has to be. And so you get this decomposition of your entanglement entropy in this P superselection sectors. So P referring to the electric field. And then, so this gauge invariant matrix product state that I did not show you explicitly, but it turns out that what you get are matrix product state, matrix product states where you have to, where you have a bond dimension per P sector. And the name of the game is then to distribute your bond dimensions along the different P sectors in order to successfully capture the states. And we kind of, so we had to do this manually. So we distribute our bond dimensions. So here we effectively truncate at electric field 3. So this is 0, 1, 2, 3, minus 1, minus 2, minus 3. You do this, then you do your simulation. For instance, this was done with a imaginary time evolution using TDVP. And then you end up with a distribution of your Schmidt coefficients. So this is a log plot. And then you see, OK, they are concentrated around zero, electric field zero. Well, you should look at this guy. And then, for instance, at electric field three, this is, well, already almost 10 orders. The largest Schmidt value there is almost already 10 orders of magnitude smaller than the largest one there. And
why is there no symmetry between charges, positive and negative charges?
Yes, because, well, because of the staggered formulation. Yeah. Okay. Sorry. Yes.
What did you do then on each link? Did you truncate the possible values? Is each link this guy by an infinite correspond still, or did you truncate that?
We effectively truncate in our bond dimensions, basically assigning them bond dimension zero, which is the same as truncating this Hilbert space.
Bond dimension zero.
Yeah, putting bond dimension for this sector to zero.
So do you have a lattice model where each side is finite dimensional, or you have a lattice model where half of the sides are infinite dimensional?
Well, I mean, they are infinite dimensional, but we just truncate, let's say, our Hamiltonian for each link, we truncate the Hamiltonian. We truncate the possible charges that the possible electric field.
So, so your tensor, there is a tensor per each fermionic site, and then the Born index takes care of the gauge degrees of freedom directly. There is no tensor attached to the in
yes.
Your MPS.
Yes. So well, there are different ways to do it, but for these simulations, we block. And so okay. So actually, I should point to my so we block a fermion site or a spin site and one edge into one effective site with one MPS tensor, and then
so the physical index runs over the two values of the spin or yes. electron or fermion,
yes. Yes.
and several values.
Yes.
So
yes.
how many values of the...
Well, like I show you in this case, seven values.
But I thought this was the Schmidt decomposition.
Yes, so this is the Schmidt decomposition.
That doesn't, that tells you about the Born index, not about the physical index.
So this tells us about the physical electric field. So this is just in generality, if you do a Schmidt decomposition for a gauge invariant theory, so for gauge invariant states obeying Gauss' law, you will get this decomposition always, huh? Where these are the electric field values. These are these electric field values. And then the way we write down our matrix public states, this physical index, if you want, this physical electric field translates to a virtual label. And then in these virtual labels, per label, so per electric field, we can assign a bond dimension. So that's the way it works. Yes. Yeah, indeed, because I skipped this, it was hard to guess this, I guess.
What happens with gauge invariance when you do this truncation? Is it still preserved in some form?
Yes, it's perfectly gauge invariant, this thing. Yes. I will not go to, because we have very nice results, because I don't have, the nicest results are on the real time simulations that we did. But okay, it would be like harsh to give you, I mean, it's doing injustice to the beauty of these simulations to present them you in 2 minutes, I think. But I will just go a bit deeper into this gauge invariance, because in the end, it amounts to, because you were asking about this, so in the end, effectively, it amounts to having matrices in your matrix product state, which are very sparse, so with many, many zeros. So this you can really look at it in this way. And then you can ask yourself, okay, but should you really impose this gauge invariance? Because you have something like Ilitzer's theorem, which tells you that gauge invariance cannot be broken spontaneously. Meaning that if you simulate your gauge invariant Hamiltonian on the full Hilbert space, the ground state will be the proper ground state. Will be a gauge invariant state, gauge invariant ground state. And so we actually...
No, that's not the meaning of the theorem, I'm sorry.
Ah, okay. Well,
I don't think that's the case. If you simulate in an extended Hilbert space, you will definitely have extra matrix elements in the game, and your energy will go... I would expect that the energy will go down.
No, so it doesn't. So it's really Ilitzer's theorem really tells you that the ground state, so I'm talking about the ground state, is, obeys your gauge constraints on the full Hilbert space. So, you can believe Ilitzer or not, but we tested this at least for the Schwinger model. So what we did just to, to play with this, so we took the same matrix, so again, already truncating electric field. So this is effectively truncating the Hamiltonian for the electric fields up to 3 or something like that, 3 minus 3. But we didn't impose gauge invariance, so we just basically filled all the zeros. And then we didn't impose this particular structure. And then we did the same simulation, so to compare, so either with the gauge invariant form explicit or with the general form. And so what we find is, you can maybe look at this comparison. So this is without imposing gauge invariance. And so you indeed find that you converge to the same ground state. So this is my gauge constraint squared. And so it's effectively zero. Here it's by definition, by construction, zero. But then you can look at the difference in simulation time. So this is for the same effective total bond dimension. And you get 6.5 hours versus 5 minutes for this distribution of bond dimensions. And you can understand if you learn your algorithm that you have these sparse matrices, this will for sure help. But there's actually an extra reason. You also see that you have many more steps if you use your imaginary time evolution, many more steps in this case to converge. And the reason is actually that is your theory on the full Hilbert space. Well, it's nearly critical. So what you have on the full Hilbert space are string states. So we have one side here, one side there, one side there, one side there, and so on. And what I can do on the full Hilbert space, I can violate my Gauss law. So I can put charges here, giving me, for instance, an electric field here, giving me, so this is one lattice size, so giving me, for instance, in this case, an energy g squared a. So a going in limit a going to zero, you effectively have these string states effectively become massless. And this is the reason, so this is the difference between these two Hilbert spaces. And this is, well, the reason why you should, why it indeed helps to work on this gauge invariant subspace. And because I'm already 5 minutes over time, I will stop here. Thank you.
Do you have any questions?
What can you say about dynamics?
Okay, very quickly. These were not dynamics. These are dynamics. So what we looked at is the Schwinger effect. So the Schwinger effect amounts to putting a quench where you put a background electric field. So where was my beautifully written Hamiltonian there? So you change this L to an L plus alpha at time zero. We started from the ground state of the alpha zero case, and then you quench with the Hamiltonian where indeed we had this substitution where we add this background field. So what we find is that, so what you see there is the evolution of the electric field in time. So the electric field expectation value. What we find is for small but also not so small quenches is actually not a thermalizing behavior, but kind of this oscillatory behavior. So these are the, you can see the different quenches. And actually, this goes very well with the work of Gabor. Well, he wasn't talking about this yesterday, but this is an illustration from their paper. So what they looked is quenches also in a confining theory, but now Ising with a longitudinal magnetic field. And so the explanation for not having thermalization is this. Well, explanation or picture. So, but the picture is this. So according to the Cardi-Calabresi picture, we have particle pairs that spread. So you should think of your original state as a state with particle pairs of the quench Hamiltonian, quasi-particles if you want. And these quasi-particles will spread, and this will give you a thermalizing behavior. But because of the confining potential, so if these are fermions, because of the confining potential, well, they cannot spread. They are confined, and well, you get this oscillatory behavior. This is a picture, and actually the picture simply amounts to this statement. So this is the quench, so this is the zero time state where I start from, and the picture amounts to saying that this state is very well approximated by so this is now the ground state of the alpha Hamiltonian. And these are creation operators. Actually, you have two types of particles in this case, of zero momentum states of this Hamiltonian. So you basically get a coherent state with a density with zero momentum particles. And so what I just wanted to say is that you can, in fact, check this picture quantitatively. And so because we have information also on the states, and these green lines are actually, so there's no fitting here, are the plots you generate based on this picture. So this seems to work very well. And then just pop. let me maybe go to this final result. For stronger quenches, you do see kind of a thermalizing behavior. So this is the electric fields, this is particle number. And what these dashed lines here are intervals where we can estimate the thermal value, because we also did finer temperature simulations, so we can estimate the thermal value of these observables. And although we cannot definitely conclude that we have thermalization to local Gibbs ensembles, at least we have strong indications that we have. So, okay, this is like 5 minutes.
Do you keep the same truncation in the local electric field here?
Yes, so the truncation typically can stay the same. The bond dimension does not. So in this case, we used Giffre's ITBD, where basically the bond dimension will grow with your simulations. And this is the reason why we have to stop at some point.
Why did you do that? You have this, you don't propose this other method.
Yeah, but there it's harder to have like an updated bond dimension. So for ITBD, it was, and then we had to start already with a very big bond dimension. Yeah.
Other question?
Just a quick one. I mean, in the imaginary time evolution, we were showing that the initial state is basically gauge invariant, right?
Yes.
But what does it happen if you break the gauge invariant in the initial state? Is it restored after imaginary time evolution?
Well, yeah, this is what Ilitsur is telling you. And this is what we, yeah.
So what about other observables, like the spectrum of particles, of excitations above the ground state?
Yeah, so we also did that. So let me just maybe show you one slide on that. Well, no, it's not there. So this is these are the zero momentum. These are the masses. So the zero momentum excitations, and so for background field zero, we find I will just tell you what we found, not how we did it. And you find actually three excitations. And actually in this case, so already, because this guy, well, he seems to be in the continuum band of this guy, but still it's a stable one. We see it in our simulations, but also here we have an extra charge conjugation symmetry, which keeps this guy stable and prevents it from decaying to two of these guys. But then as soon as you turn on your electric field, we see it also in our simulation that this guy becomes unstable, having two excitations there. And then, we can do this for different backgrounds.
So for any ratio of M over G, you always have these two?
No, because for instance, depending on the background field, for instance, in this case, also the second excitation disappears for alpha, 0.3 or something.
But for alpha equals zero, it's not secretly integrable.
No.
But nonetheless, you get this excitation of a threshold.
Yes. Actually, the prediction by Coleman is that for smaller and smaller coupling, you should find more and more of these excitations, which are basically excitations of your charmonium or your mesonic excitation. So we have
Do you have a nice plot for the mass of the lowest meson, which would agree with perturbation theory in one regime, with strong coupling in another regime, and would interpolate between them? Something that other approaches could aim to reproduce.
So I don't have a one for the mass, but maybe.
Well, it's the simplest plot that you can imagine for it. You go all these complicated quenches and so on, but what about spectroscopy?
It's like spectroscopy.
Well, for instance, this I think is a nice one, because we can also, this is not what you want, but I like this one because it's, we can also construct eigenstates of excitations with momentum. And this is really showing you, so these blue lines are square root k squared, no, r, sorry, it's e squared, r k squared plus m squared, the Einstein dispersion relation, that goes perfectly, fits perfectly. And then maybe on kind of, well, what I the nicest cross-check for me, so using fermion perturbation theory, was this. So this is the energy density if you add if you add this background field, which is now denoted as Q. And this is in the weak coupling regime. So M over G is large, as you see. So G over M is small. And then you can compute this, well, basically by putting a background electric field and integrating out everything. And then yeah, you will get something like this. And these are the first two coefficients, well, the first two contributions to this coefficient. And so what this plot shows you is the is this contribution subtracted. So it's already with this contribution subtracted. So this is really the one loop Feynman diagram that you calculate. And this plot shows you indeed that in the appropriate regime, you're smack on what Feynman is telling you. And why? I think it's, I mean, it's you should find this, so it's nothing spectacular in that sense. But I like this because if you think about it, indeed. So what we did, we do the A naught is not gauge. We do Kohut-Suskind. Then we have our matrix product states. Then we take the continuum limit. But then obviously the other way is just use path integrals in the perturbative approach, and you indeed find well the same value.
Okay, well, let's